and capitulation in British history. On the 7th of December 1941, Japan made its infamous attack on the US Pacific Fleet at Pearl Harbor on the island of Hawaii. The attack was no isolated adventure. It was part of a carefully planned strategy that had as its objective the conquest of Southeast Asia. Malaya was a strategically and economically vital bastion of the British Empire. At that time, the Malay states provided more than half the world's tin ore and natural rubber, and they had been identified by the Japanese as territories vital to their expansion in the region as far back as 1938, in the now infamous Greater East Asia Co-Prosperity Sphere. It was this crucial area that Japan intended to conquer, with the final prize being at the very southern tip of Malaya, the historic British fortress at Singapore. Nothing was left to chance. Japan's network of imperial agents worked feverishly during the summer of 1941 to provide detailed information on the region's defenses to the military, who planned a huge air, land, and sea invasion during the early months of 1942. Japanese High Command had long since concluded that the conquest of Malaya and the capture of Singapore could not be achieved by an assault on the fortress from the sea. For the British had strengthened Singapore's defences with enormous 15-inch guns. It was decided instead to attack by the back door, an overland assault from the north that would take the Japanese forces down through Malaya and into Singapore. Plans were therefore drawn up for landings to be launched from the Gulf of Siam, which would put troops ashore at Patani, Singora, and Kota Baru. The Japanese also planned to advance through the dense Malayan jungle and to hook up behind the British forces that they knew would be expecting an attack by road. Like the attack on Pearl Harbor, the Japanese realized that the element of surprise was crucial to the success of the whole ambitious operation, and it was decided not to carry out preliminary bombardments of the landing positions. It was a sign of the confidence of the Japanese that the plan allowed only 100 days to secure victory. In the event, it was achieved in only 70. The British strategy for the Far East was centered on the defense of Singapore itself. Huge amounts of money, some £60 million, had been spent on strengthening the fortress there, and the project had become something of a political hot potato during the 1930s. Despite work starting, stopping, and restarting several times, the Changi Naval Base was finally completed in 1938. As we have already seen, the defences at Singapore had been constructed solely to withstand an invasion from the sea. Alongside the massive 15-inch gun emplacements, four airfields were also constructed. and there is no doubt that the Changi naval base was considered by British High Command to be impregnable to seaborne attack. Unfortunately, fewer provisions had been made for an attack on the base by land, the dangers of which had been clearly pointed out in a report sent to British Chiefs of Staff as long ago as 1937. The recommendations in the report were ignored. It would prove to be a costly mistake. Like the Americans at Pearl Harbor, the British cause was not helped by a general lack of respect for the fighting capabilities of the Japanese. The British also believed that it would be impossible for the Japanese to launch a surprise attack from the sea, simply because Japan was so far away. They also reasoned that if an attack did come, they would also be able to rely on help from the US Pacific Fleet in Hawaii. All these factors combined to produce a sense of complacency at the Changi base that the Japanese were quick to exploit. In command of the Japanese 25th Army was Tomoyuki Yamashita, a highly regarded leader, who through his exploits earned the nickname the Tiger of Malaya. A superb strategist, Yamashita had been sent on a special military mission to Germany and Italy in 1940, during which he had meetings with Hitler and Mussolini. He returned to Japan with severe misgivings about any war with the US or Britain, which he felt should be postponed until Japan had thoroughly modernized its army and air force. That view did not match with the nationalist fervor and mood for action that swept through pre-war Japan. A fine leader of men, Renta Mutoguchi had progressed steadily through the ranks of the Japanese army since his graduation from military academy in 1910. After promotion from the position of Yamashita's chief of staff, he was given command of the 18th Division, then stationed in China. It was this division which performed so well under Mutoguchi's leadership during the Malaya and Singapore campaign. Arthur Percival had been commander of the British forces in Malaya since July 1941, after a distinguished career during which he had served as a divisional commander in Britain and General Dill's chief of staff in France. The problems facing him, as the Japanese poured into Malaya, though, were different from any he had confronted before. Suddenly, he was placed in charge of poorly prepared troops that were being asked to repulse a confident, highly motivated and determined enemy. If Percival was to prove unequal to the task, it was questionable whether any Allied general, given the same resources, would have been capable of shielding Malaya and Singapore from the Japanese invaders. Henry Gordon Bennett served in the First World War, ending it with the rank of Brigadier General, and was appointed General Officer commanding Australian Imperial Forces in Malaya in 1941. These forces were stationed at first at Johor, under the umbrella of the Australian 8th Division. Under Bennett's command, the Australians were responsible for some courageous delaying actions as the Japanese advanced through Malaya, particularly at the River Moir, in January 1942. Bennett's style of leadership, however, attracted much criticism during and after the Malaya campaign and the fall of Singapore. Sir Robert Brooke Popham had retired from